home of McMurdo and Marvin Dunmore, Higgins Lake. And McMurdo's going to give us a little tape for the Roscommon Area Historic Society.
Okay.
So now I want you to say that this tape will belong to the Historic Society.
This tape will belong to the Roscommon Area Historical Society.
Let's have you tell us the name of your parents.
My father's name was Anders Gustav Rydell, and he was born in Sweden and came over to the United States when he was 21 years old.
Oh, okay.
And my mother's name was Ada Frederica Carlson, and she was 23 years old when she came to this country. And she said she used to dream about America. She said she was just very anxious to come.
Did they know each other in Sweden?
No.
Oh.
They met in the United States. And her younger brother was already here.
Oh.
And so she did have someone she knew.
She came over, did she live with him then?
I wasn't as aware of how important this history would be to me even in later years.
Yeah.
And I didn't think to ask a lot of questions. So I feel really bad that I hadn't discussed it with her. But she did work for many rich people. And she said there was one attorney that lived on Long Island. And there was only the two, the husband and wife. And she said after she had worked for her, she was never afraid to work for anybody else.
Because she was so mean?
No, she was...
that gave her confidence?
Gave her confidence.
Uh-huh.
She was a very nice person. She used to take care of her room and get her bed ready for at night, open it up and do things like that. They had two cooks, and they had a very large estate and a couple gardeners, and it was just, they just got a lot of money.
Wow. And how long did she work for those people?
I really don't know. My parents were married in 1913. And they lived in DeKalb, Illinois. I think that's where they got married.
Oh, so do you know what ran from Long Island to DeKalb? How did she
No.
get there?
See, we were kind of
dumb
about
you don't know.
Inquiring about those things.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they read the ad in the Chicago papers about what a beautiful place this was and rich ground you could grow anything, you know. And so my dad bought the place up here. I think you could buy a house and everything for about $100.
Yeah. What had he been doing in DeKalb?
He had been working in a machine shop.
Oh, okay.
And
so
he just thought he wouldn't last long in that hard work, you know.
Sure.
But so he wanted to come up here. And the I don't know what month they arrived, but my sister Gertrude was a year and a half old, and that's when they came, and my mom said...
And what year was that?
1915, yeah. And she said they had, my dad had planted, like rye and different things in the fields, and they had this was in April. And in May, they had a big snowstorm, and I guess it probably killed everything. But and the winters were pretty hard. He did go back one year to work in the city and make a little money.
Here.
Yeah, she stayed here. They did have neighbors, probably a quarter of a mile.
You know, where did your parents buy property?
On the corner of East Higgins Lake Drive and Burdell Road, over here, where the trees.
Where Conroe would have, is East Higgins Lake Drive the same as Conroe?
No, no, it's not.
No.
Okay, it turns in at Town and Country Store.
Oh, okay. And how much land did they have?
I think they had 20 acres at the time. And
was
they had
a home there?
A few cows. The home was only a 24-foot square. Kind of a not a very nice home. It had tar paper on the outside and just nothing to it much.
Mm-hmm.
They were My mother was quite disappointed. She says, I still think about my nice little white house in DeKalb.
Yeah.
But
did they fix that house up?
Yeah, eventually. I don't think it ever had any insulation in it. Mm-hmm. Of course, they burned wood all the time. And
sure. Yeah. The picture that you showed me of it had porches on two sides.
Yes.
Did your father put that on?
No, evidently it was like that, when they came.
Mm-hmm.
Because later they took that down and just built a little porch in the front. Then in 1936, the government was buying up land around whoever wanted to sell, and he had an idea he'd like to. I think he had built a little gas station, because farming was no good, and he had a little gas station on the corner near the house.
Oh.
And I think the foundation is still there.
For the gas station?
Yeah, they had the house sold to the government, and for around 2,000, I think. That was in 1936. And then they moved the house and the station over to the corner where Lance's eventually bought the place.
Okay, it sounds like
Don and Lee Lance. Mm-hmm. And,
so, did your father farm? How many years did he try to farm, do you think?
Well, quite a number of years.
Yeah. You said they had cows?
Yes, and they had cows. I remember one old cow that was mean, and we were always out of her way. But they had, he trained horses. We had one horse that my sister used to ride. Her name was Dolly. But he would cut the hay, you know, and ride on the wagon with him, and we kind of enjoyed that. Go get the cows at night. So a lot of the, I don't know, not a lot, but a few of the people in the Swedish settlement, they used to let their cows roam around, and we knew them by what kind of cows they had.
Uh-huh.
Well, there's Cedermans, or there's Carlson's uh-huh. cows. And,
okay. So the cows intermingled, you mean? They just were?
Well, they come in their own bunch, you know. They didn't seem to uh-huh. meet up with each other, I guess.
Uh-huh.
But my dad always had ours fenced in, he didn't want it. And Mr. Rosquist had cows that would wander around, and they would come down to the lake here and get water in the early morning, and their cowbells would be ringing. I guess he made the cowbells. And
what was that name?
Rosquist. It was Ruth Gaudet's father.
R-O-S-E?
R-O-S-Q-U-I-S-T. And Mr. Alexander would go out and undo the bell from the leader of the herd, and Mr. Rosquist would have to go make another cowbell.
Oh, Mr. Alexander didn't like the cowbell.
No, he didn't like that noise in the morning.
Oh, sure.
I had two half-sisters. My father was married before, and his wife had died, and Ruth and Lillian were probably 12 and 10 or something like that when my mother married him. But they stayed in Chicago, although Lillian would spend some time up here, and she worked for different people, and everywhere she went, she talked about walking here, walking there, and you know, there's no cars, you didn't get chauffeured around anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
But they used to meet in different homes, and they'd have dances like on Saturday night or something. And they'd play the Victrolas
up here.
With polkas and different dance music.
Did they still do that when you were a teenager?
Not when I was a teenager, no. It was when I was very small.
Mm-hmm. Did the whole family go? Like, did you go with them?
No. It seemed like they were all older than me, and I used to cry because I couldn't go along different places. But,
you got left behind.
Yeah.
Okay, so you had a sister, Gertrude, that was already...
The older sisters, half-sisters, were Ruth and Lillian,
right.
And then Gertrude, and Then Elsie and Eunice and I were all born at that same corner. And I have pictures of them when they first started school. And Louise Murphy Dow was my first teacher. They had no kindergarten, so it was first grade.
And that was at the Wayne School?
At the Wayne School.
Which is now the Messiah Lutheran Church.
Yeah, and she's still living and a resident at Hilltop.
Oh.
So I have been in to see her, mm-hmm. and she's still remembered.
So you started school at the Wayne School about
1927. I was 7 years old in September. Mm-hmm.
And how many students were in your class?
There was Pearl Soderholm and Lillian Johnson. And Doris Willett went to that school for a while. Her mother was a school teacher at the Willett School, they called. But I don't remember. It was over near Brian Willett's home. I don't know if the school is still there. I don't think so. Well, we had to walk 2 miles to school, you know, from our corner. And in the wintertime, my dad would take us in the sleigh with the two horses, and they'd go across the fields because roads weren't plowed in those days. And he'd take the best route,
so
the horses could get through.
Sure.
And
In that Wayne School, how many grades were there?
Eight grades.
There were eight grades.
First, and two of the boys.
All in one?
Oh, I got some mail. Thanks.
Were they all in one classroom?
Oh, yes. And
so the one that teacher taught
that
all
one
eight grades.
Knew for drama.
My sister Elsie finished the fourth or fifth grade. She was almost 10, and she got very ill at the end of the school year, and she contacted somehow spinal meningitis, and the doctor, Camilla, would come out to see her, but there wasn't anything he could do for her. And she died on my mother's birthday.
Oh,
and that year.
At home?
She died at home. And the undertaker came out to the house to take care of her, and it was a real hot day, and they got a big chunk of ice and put it in the wash tub and put it in the room with her to try to keep it cool. And those are some of my first memories, because I was going to be 5 in September, and she would have been 10 in August.
So what day was this
on? On June 6, 1925.
So right after
she complained about such a severe headache, and then she later went into coma. Well, that was pretty hard.
Oh, I'm sure it was horrible for your family.
Oh, we used to have Christmas programs in the evening at school, too.
Oh.
I imagine they had, like, lanterns or something to light things up. Because I remember one play I was in, and Bill Granlin and I were the grandparents, and we stood behind a big picture frame, and then in the process of the play, we'd come out and talk to each other, but that's
that
as much as I remember about
it. Cute.
Yeah, it was funny.
Yeah.
And my sister Bert, she had to, she did a monologue about all these presents that people had given her and remarked about each one, you know. And one of our neighbors, they used to come over for Thanksgiving dinner, and she says, "You look like a real person." But you know how some people will discuss their gifts.
That was part of the program.
Yeah,
though.
Part of the program.
Isn't that nice?
And we rode over in the sleigh, and with the horses pulling us.
Yeah. Did you have to take your lunch?
Oh, yes. I always remember those peanut butter sandwiches.
So the building was just heated with wood, I imagine.
Yeah, it was a big furnace, and I remember Bill Granlin putting wood in it a lot of times. And after Christmas vacation one year, I remember we came back to school, and someone had broke in, and they had moved There was an old organ out in the back room, and they had moved it up into the vestibule where they rang the bell, you know. And the things were kind of stirred up, even in those days.
Yeah.
It was surprising. And the boys would play tricks on the teacher. They'd tied a snake to a bell rope one time, and they'd put a mouse in their desk drawer, and then go up and ask for a pencil, because the township paid for paper and pencils at those times.
Mm-hmm. Did she have pretty good control generally?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I remember Louise Murphy. She would really shout at those older boys. Mm-hmm. Oh, there were two boys that loved to trap skunks. And I wondered if they sometimes would do it on purpose, because they'd come to school really reeking of skunk. Oh. So she'd send them home.
Good for her.
Then I don't remember how it started, because I didn't pay enough attention, but they talked about consolidating the schools into the two townships, and that was in 1929. It was voted on. They had a lot of arguments over it, of course. So then we went to the new school in Roscommon.
Well, so you only went there for like 3 or 4 years.
I was in fifth grade,
fifth grade.
At that time, and then graduated.
How did you get to school then?
Well, then they had 3 buses. Ours was number one, and it went down, started at Flag Point, and came around and up to the Irish Park, and then out on the highway into Roscommon, and there was, on the way, you know, kids to pick up. So it was pretty much bus full by the time we got to Roscommon. I think Howard Bartenfeller was the last one on.
Mm. Do you remember who the school bus driver was?
Oh, yes. Our first bus driver was, his name was Bob Ogden, and it mentions in here about the corner where he used to have the
township.
Yeah.
Okay.
And he had a little gas station there and sold some baked goods. I don't know, probably his wife baked them, because there was nothing like that around here. But we just loved him. He was the nicest fellow, and he was always singing and saying good morning and good night.
Sure.
And every payday, he handed out a candy bar to each one of us.
Really?
Every payday.
Isn't that nice?
And then he died suddenly, had a heart attack, and just couldn't believe it. We really missed him.
Sure. Then when you went
fifth grade, the school wasn't quite ready to have us move in, and we, there was an old church building across the road. I can't remember what it was. And we had classes there. And Emma T. Wiseman, she was our teacher at the time. And I don't remember me being so smart in school at that time. But she gave me all A's. And she was real happy one day I came to school. And she says, I'm going to put you in the sixth grade. And I was kind of lost, you know.
Uh-huh.
I wasn't used to the kids, and they were studying adverbs, and I hadn't learned about them, and I was afraid to ask, you know, questions. So.
Uh-huh.
But it eventually
just
worked
like that,
out.
Yeah,
so
out.
I was only 60. I was 17 when I graduated.
Mm-hmm.
Graduated in 1937. So.
You did all right. It sounds like.
Not too great. Oh, in the last year of high school, they introduced our, what do I want to say? I forget words. We got typing that year, and bookkeeping, and shorthand.
Oh.
So we got to take
good
that.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
So like a business
had,
course.
Mm-hmm, business course. So, I never forgot the typewriter keys.
Great.
Still remember.
Well, so when you went into Roscommon then, was fifth grade just only the fifth grade when you went?
No, fifth and sixth.
Were together.
Were together. Yeah, we were paired off quite a bit of the time. One time we were, yeah, I suppose when we were up in the high school area, or they had
more individual
classes.
Yeah. So what happened to the women's school then?
Well, the ladies' aid had started, the Lutheran Ladies Aid had started up, and they bought the place for $327, something like that. And then they deeded it over to the church later. So that's how we got our church.
So right away it started, as soon as you vacated it in 1929, they started to use it?
Mm-hmm.
So it didn't sit vacant much then?
No.
Well, that was good.
Of course, we didn't have a permanent pastor.
Mm-hmm.
After. Well, it was 1935 when the church organized, so there was quite a few years in there. We used to, at noontime, you know, we could walk around town and go by the stores and buy penny candy. There was all kinds of that. The Chase store right by the railroad track where the dime store was there at one time and different things since then. I don't know what's in it now, but then McConkie's was next to that and the St. Vincent de Paul stores. And then Kylie's was down on the corner where the print shop is.
Mm-hmm.
And we liked to go by the DeWales drugstore. That was a favorite place to get ice cream in the summer.
Well, sure.
Ice cream cones. When we were real small kids, that was about the only time we got to town was in the summertime. Because my sisters would take the train from Chicago at 11 o'clock at night, and they had a sleeper, and they'd get up here in Roscommon the next day around 3 or 3:30. That's how they used to come up on vacations.
Did you meet them at the train
station?
Oh,
yeah, that was a big big deal in the summertime. We'd go out and wash the car. And
sure.
Yes, stuff. My mother wasn't too excited about it because she always had more meals to cook, and she let them take over their bedroom because our house was very small. And I think sometimes, excuse me, they went out and slept in the hay because we didn't have any more room. We had, for a few years, you know, we had three kids in one bed.
Yeah,
when my sister Gertrude was still home.
So when the girls came, they came for the whole summer?
No, for 2 weeks.
Oh, they just came for 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't too long.
We were talking about, I was reading about roads and stuff, and I remember the first time we went over to, you know, where the O'Reins lived, where the expressway goes through. Dagny O'Rean, you don't know her. Dagny Schaffnitz, yeah. But their house was right there where the expressway goes through on Federal Highway.
Oh.
And we had to go into Roscommon and back out, and that road was quite mucky. And I was always kind of afraid of driving anywhere where the roads were bad, especially what they call the muck road from the post office up to, not to the golf course, but just that swampy area through there. It was a real narrow road, and I was always afraid we were going to end up in the ditch.
Do you remember your father's first family car?
Yeah, it's over there. I got a picture of it here, too. A Model T.
Was it?
I don't remember where it came from. Yeah, and our Swedish neighbor waited
down.
Did your
father teach you to drive?
No, and later they got a Model A, and my sister Eunice and I used to get out there, and we'd sit, well, you put in the clutch, you know, and then put it in gear, and then you release the clutch and step on the gas. So we'd go through all the motions first.
Uh-huh.
So I knew how to drive. But I was afraid of hills. I was just a real scaredy cat. My sisters used to tease me and scare me a lot, so it's no wonder I got.
They tripped on you, didn't
Yeah.
They?
Not real mean, but enough to make me worry about it. Anyway,
sure.
I was 16 when I started to drive. My dad went with me. And
did your mother drive also?
No, she didn't.
She never drove.
She said she always felt more comfortable with me driving than with my dad.
Well, that was pretty nice compliment to you.
He didn't have anybody really teaching him, you know. One of the fellows, Lloyd Paulin, he said these older folks around, he said they, how was it, they drove defensively, didn't they?
Yeah.
And they didn't always stop at stop streets, you know. There were no signs or anything, but.
Hard to imagine all that.
Yeah. And when we would go to Roscommon, we'd have to go out straight from our house on the dirt road, you know, that goes, I don't know the name of that street down there, but 100 was not open in those early days.
Oh, okay.
No, there was maybe a little trail road. And before we got married, they had it gravel. They had it all opened up. Because I was driving, we were in Bud's car and I was driving, and we started up 100 from the cemetery,
yeah.
You know, and turned left up that street. And I got stuck in the sand, and instead of racing on through, you know, I slowed down, and he had to work pretty hard to get out of there.
Oh, dear.
So that was in about 1940, 39 or 40. So it was pretty nice after we got that opened up. And there's a picture in here about the road to Markey. It was very open. I remember it looking like that. Oh, when we were just kids, our neighbor down the road where the cemetery is now, that was his property, and he would get his mail in our mailbox, and it was up on Maplehurst. So we'd walk from our corner up towards Maplehurst.
Which is a half a mile?
Yeah, half a mile. And then in the summertime, he'd have us bring up his mail to us, and he'd give us pennies, Indian head pennies, and cookies, Ginger's naps, or some kind of good cookies he liked.
Well, that's nice. Being the mail service person.
Well, there's a lot of Swedes around there, and sometimes, not sometimes, but they got in the habit of celebrating birthdays. The husbands and wives would meet because that was one way to keep in touch.
Sure. You know. Now, when you say Swedetown, how large of an area do you
Well, it really took in... I think it's Pinewood Drive.
Where
Soderholm's and Martinson's and Cedarman's and Carlson's. Mm-hmm. They call that Swedetown.
And where were Granlund's?
Granlund's were up on where 100 is, where the road comes up from Soderholm's. They were on that corner.
Oh,
Carol Austin has that house.
And then so out in this area with
There was no one near us. Years earlier, I barely remember, the Andersons used to live just east of our home, and it was about halfway between our house and 100. But then they moved back to the city, and eventually the house was taken down, I guess.
Somebody. So your father didn't own all the way to 100?
No, he just 20 acres.
Okay.
We had fruit trees up on the hill, and a couple of years they grew strawberries, a great big, nice, beautiful. We used to go up there and pick strawberries. And one yellow plum tree and some winter apples.
Mm. So they were moderately successful with the fruit. Are any of those trees still there?
No. They're all gone.
Okay, let's go back to when your father sold the property to the state. Then was all of the property planted in Red Pine?
In 1959, they planted those trees.
Well, what did they do with the land from 1936 till then?
It was just vacant.
Oh, they just left it.
I have one picture where it was in 1943, I think, in the fall, and Bud and I were driving around that corner. Mel was with us, a little tight, And we saw three deer under the apple trees down below in the front yard. So I took a picture of it somewhere and here I got it. So it was vacant for many years until they planted those trees.
So those trees are about 40 years old.
Mm-hmm. And I worked at the lake for different families in the summertime.
That's when you were a teenager?
Mm-hmm. One family I worked for at Lakeside, I'd walk down to the, we lived at that corner there where Lance's were.
Right,
by that time. And I have to walk the beach and go up to Lakeside. Mm-hmm. And they had a great big house, and I'd clean that house and maybe do a few little dishes. And then the daughter had a little girl, 4 years old, and I had no idea about what 4-year-olds would acted like at that time. And I'd have to take her to dinner in the evening at 6 o'clock at the dining hall. And I got $5 a week.
Wow. I hope that you were able to eat with her.
I don't think so. I don't think so. The lady would buy things for my lunch and I'd eat in the house.
So did you come place. Home every evening from
mm-hmm.
that you walked home
mm-hmm. And then another family, straight down to the lake, I got a job there 1 year, and she was from Ohio.
Oh.
And I used to work every day there.
Did your sisters do that also?
They got jobs waiting table at Cheney's Hotel. It's over near Alameda Beach.
Oh.
You know where Harry and Laverne Myers' cottage used to be? Well, it's down in that area. And,
then how long was that a hotel? I don't remember that.
It might have told him there, but I don't remember. It just made gave names.
Shaney, you were saying Shaney?
Mm-hmm, Chaney. Was there for many years.
That was, and that would have been considered a good job for them, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, then also, all three of you girls graduated from high school.
No, my sister Gert, she went to Chicago. She wanted to stay in Roscommon and go to high school and, you know, work for a family, but
uh-huh.
it didn't work out. And I felt real sad when she left because she wasn't very old at the time. But she would, she'd work for families that would spend summer vacations at some lake or somewhere so she could go home for the summer, and then she worked at the hotels in the summertime. And then she'd go back to. Mm-hmm.
You mean like, did she go away like for the 10th and 11th grade already? 9th, 10th grade, you mean?
No, we had 8 grades in
so she went
at Wayne. She finished 8th grade.
Oh, so she didn't go into Roscommon?
No. She didn't get the chance to go.
Then she finished, did she finish high school in Chicago?
Mm-mm. No.
But now you did.
Yeah. Yes, I did. And
so you were
didn't
the first
do much
one.
Of anything after that.
You were the first one in your...
No, Eunice did graduate the year before me.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was nice. You went to high school together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the high schools were quite different.
Mm-hmm.
The balcony over the gymnasium was a place where we sat and ate our lunch. And it seemed like we had a lot of grape jelly sandwiches, and after a while, you can get tired of those,
mm-hmm.
like George and his peanut butter joke.
Yeah.
Anyway, the Aubrey girls, they'd have like bologna or hot dogs and all the good stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of envy that, but
sure.
You live through it.
Why, sure. Then in high school, Did you participate? You said you didn't do basketball because you thought you were too thin.
Well, I just didn't.
You were athletic.
I was too shy.
Uh-huh. Did you do other things in high school?
There really wasn't anything much else to do.
That's awkward,
right? Oh, I did join they call it a glee club, the chorus.
Sure.
Yeah, sang in that for a while.
Yeah.
And we sang at special little doings sometimes.
You used to be in
sometime.
The choir church.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's talk about the starting of the church, because your mother and dad helped a lot with that, you said.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was the beginning of the Ladies Aid group that really helped a lot,
mm-hmm.
getting the building and getting in touch with pastors.
Mm-hmm.
My cousin Emma Sargent knew Dr. Rydbeck from Cadillac, and I don't know, through them, and then this head of the Rock Island, what would you call it? Fellow's name was Dr. Peter Peterson, and he was head of the it wasn't called Synod, I'm trying to think of the name. Anyway, he came up here and visited with all the families.
Mm-hmm.
And they had given word that they would like to organize a church. And that was in 1935. And I was in the first confirmation class the next year.
Oh, who was the minister that confirmed you then?
The new pastor over at Cadillac was Dr. Carl Lorimer. And we had our teacher during the summer was Fred Benson. And he did get to be a minister, and they had called him and wanted him to come, but he had other plans.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, the pastor that we did get eventually, I think we mostly had student pastors during the summer.
Mm-hmm.
And then, the memory fails me. But then the pastor from Traverse City would come every other Sunday and every other Sunday to Mancelona, to that Lutheran church there.
The Austins told about that the different families would feed the minister.
Yes, because our service would be at 3:30 in the afternoon, because they would hold service at 11 at Traverse. And by the time they could drive down here, it would be 3:30, and then everybody's hungry after that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they'd take turns and invite the pastor over. I always remember when my cousin Emma Sargent would invite him over, her husband would always have jokes for the pastor, you know, entertain him.
Uh-huh.
But they were not mean or nasty, yeah. And he was always good about it.
Sure. How many were in your confirmation class?
Six of us. Edna Lynn was one, and she lived Petty Corner from our old Irish Hall down there. Edna and Edna Osling, and two silver home girls, Pearl and Ella, and then my sister Eunice and I. I got pictures of that too.
Sure.
Yeah.
So where did you meet? Did Bud grow up here also?
No, he grew up in Detroit, and his dad had bought property here from Mr. Alexander in about 1930, I think. And they came up summertimes and kind of camped the first year or so. And then they had the house built. Bud's cousin built it. And
Bud's father's name?
John Moore. And then later, Bud bought the lot next door to him. He paid he paid $600 for it at that time, 50 feet. Mm-hmm. Rafa had 100 here. Mm-hmm.
So between the two of them, they had 150 feet.
Mm-hmm. And then when Rafa died, Bud's sister said, why don't we divide the property and you can have the house with a shop on it. Because they had a shop out there at that time.
Okay. His father already had that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, he and Bud built it together.
Oh.
And then Marie would rent the house we used to have, but that didn't work out too well.
She rented it for herself, or she rented
yeah,
it out?
Yeah, for herself. No, she rented it in the summertime, but it wasn't the greatest house. Mm-hmm. And when people come up and spend, at that time, $125 a week was quite a bit of money.
Mm-hmm.
And they liked things a little nicer. Mm-hmm. And I didn't blame them at all. So it was kind of difficult for her. And then she eventually sold it. And then some fellow that used to be on the township board, he and his brother got a hold of it and divided it right in two. Because it was 130-some feet long. So here we have neighbors much closer than we would have had
yeah.
if they hadn't divided the property.
Oh. They divided it from the lakefront and the back
mm-hmm.
lot, you
know? Yeah, and the first people that bought in the back, because it was a little more reasonable,
uh-huh.
they had 15 feet of right-of-way to get to the lake, so these people only have 60 feet. Yeah, we didn't like the idea, but they'd already gone through with it before we heard anything about it.
So what year were you married?
We were married in 1941 on the 1st of November. And I always remember the first day of the World War II because we were, Bud and I were riding with his folks out to Ypsilanti to see his aunt. And we got out there and they had just heard the news on the radio. So he started right in with war work. We lived in Dearborn, and he got a job over on 8 Mile Road. So he had a long ride to work every day.
So were your children born down
here? Mel was born in, I forgot the name of the hospital, Oakwood, I think, in Dearborn, West Dearborn. And then, I don't know, Bud says I got lonesome for home, and I thought he kind of wanted to go north too, but he found a place for us to rent. I said, people probably thought I was crazy, because I left my husband down there working, and here I was. But I was so thankful to have raised the kids up here.
Sure.
I don't think I would have made it down there.
And your parents were still here?
Yes. My mother was still alive we moved up in April, and the following year, Bud's mother died, and then 9 months later, my mother died.
Oh, so moved up here like in 42 or how?
42.
Yeah.
No, 43, because Loretta was born in December. And my mother just saw her take her first steps.
Oh.
She died in January.
Of 45.
Mm-hmm.
And was your father still alive?
Yeah, he lived for, I forget dates, many years after. He was he was almost 89 when he died.
Well, it was nice that he had
mm-hmm.
you here.
And that was when he sold a family house to Don and
May.
Mm-hmm. And then.
So he lived there until he died?
No, he bought a little house in Roscommon. And it's still there. It's next to what used to be Robbins. Let's see, you know where the lumber yard is? And then the street goes across, and then right on that corner, there was a Canadian house there, and then there's a little house set back. And then the next one was Robbins. The husband used to be the undertaker.
Oh, Yeah, that house is still, that's an historic house, really.
Yeah.
Your dad lived in the one next to it?
The middle one. I think it's painted green yet.
On the same side of the street as Robin's?
Yeah, right next door. I think maybe the front part of it is not there anymore. Because it was like a little porch in the front. And he had a bed out there. When my sisters would come up in the summer, they had the main room. And they put in an inside toilet and one end of the kitchen. He used to keep a real good house. Oh, I've got a picture of him and Hal Shepherd. That's from way back. I hope I can find it. He was one of the old timers in Roscommon and one of the ladies that worked at Green's Tavern. Hal Shepherd's house was on the same side of the street as where the flower shop is and the furniture place.
Oh, on Lake Street?
Yeah.
On the same side of the street where the flower shop is now?
The village shop. Right in there somewhere on this side of the village shop.
Okay.
And they were sitting on the step. And they looked somewhat like at a distance, and our kids, I'd be driving in town, and they said, "There's Grandpa." It looked sort of like him because they were about the same size.
Uh-huh.
Shoot, I took it to coffee hour one Saturday to show Liz, and that's probably in it. Yeah, it'll be a bit later.
Did your family go into the theater a lot when you were young? Did you go into movies?
I was 13 or 14 before I saw my first movie. The kids that
Do you remember what it was?
No. No, I can't remember. So that wasn't something we got around to do. Bud and I used to take my mom with us, and a lot of times there were like Gene Autry and some of those westerns.
Mm-hmm.
And she
well,
said
when
she,
you were growing up, did your family play cards a lot? Or?
No, I think probably Ruth and Lil taught us how to play cards.
Did they?
And we just loved it. I still love to play cards.
Yeah.
And then with some of the Swedes that would be in the neighborhood. They were from the Chicago area too, but not from the Swede town. But these other ones that would come up summertimes, they liked to play hearts.
Oh.
And they used to get real huffy, you know.
Get excited over that
yeah.
Black queen, huh?
Yeah.
So. Did you learn quilting and sewing and all that from your mother?
No, she would do it, and we were always there, and we watched, you know, and there was... Not that she actually taught us, but we saw what went on and just picked it
you
up.
You just learned it.
Yeah.
Did you start to quilt as a young girl?
I had two quilts made before we were married.
Did you?
I sewed the tops. One was a fan quilt. The other one was just little pieces like a 9 square, but they were all small.
Uh-huh.
And then Marie and the frame, we set up the frames out here, and Marie helped quilt them.
Did you have a big wedding?
No.
Were
I don't
you
know. I
at our church?
I don't know what possessed me because I was so naive and stupid, I think. I never thought about having, but our minister was from Ottawa City at the time.
Oh.
And he would come. Oh, I can't remember the times. It must have been about the same time of day. But we had to share him with Thomas Church at that time. His name was Edwin Gustafson. And we went over to the, you know, the house where he lives.
The rectory?
The rectory, yeah.
Parsonage.
And got married, Parsonage, got married there.
In Thomas?
Yeah.
Oh, well,
and then came back, and my mom had a little reception for us at her house.
Oh, that was nice.
She had chicken salad, and she made the best rolls. And Ruth today owned a Town and Country. She made our wedding cake and ordered it from her.
Well, you had a nice party then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So Bud was a summer resident that you met him because he was here in the summer.
Well, he was working at the time too, because he and Marie got acquainted with the Haineses, Betty Bartlett's parents. They were caretakers at Lag Point at that time, and he got acquainted with them, and that's where I met him.
Because were you working at Lag Point?
No, I did at different times, but I went to visit.
Oh,
Betty.
Betty, I see.
Yeah. And her mother. Yeah.
What was that Lag Point where people worked?
They were privately owned cottages, but it was like a group. They didn't want anybody else in. You know, they each owned their own house, and they had a caretaker there that they would pay.
Oh.
And that's how.
Like Hive Grove is now, kind of thing.
Kind of, but they didn't have a big dining hall because they're not. I don't know how many cottages are there.
What are the big changes you think at Higgins Lake?
Oh, it's all the houses and so many people. It was so nice to see the plain beach without all this boat hoist and docks and everything. I've got pictures that show nice open areas.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of my two of my sisters that were alive, they came up in later years, were able to get here. And you'd take them around and over familiar places, but they couldn't recognize what it was. With the trees grown up so much and so many houses, they were always.
Now, when you first came here, then there weren't all these trees, were there?
No. In fact, when I first knew Bud, the trees were so small that the sun beat down and be hot in the summertime. And when I worked at the lake over straight out from where we lived on Lance's Corner, those places had these big pines,
mm-hmm.
and you go in there and it's nice and cool.
Right.
I thought, gee, it was so hot over here, the sun beating down, and eventually we got a cool spot.
Sure, sure. Did your father fish?
He told my mom before they moved up here, he says, well, we're right near the lake. He says, I can fish. And she said he went out once, and that was about the end of it.
Oh, really?
He got into farming and stuff, and
sure,
I guess he never seemed to take the time. And just like Bud never took the time to take the boys out.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, Grandpa maybe wasn't used to little kids, because he didn't bother with taking them out either. Our kids.
Yeah, Bud's dad.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But he fished.
Oh, yeah. And Bud's mother loved fishing. They would get big schools of rock bass, and she would fry them up so delicious. She was a good cook. Well, my mother was too, but they had different.
You're an excellent cook, yes. You were such a baker. Your mother must have been a good cook.
Yeah, she was. With what little she had, I can still taste her good food.
Yeah, she must have started out on a wood cook stove.
Oh, yes. She made Asian food cakes on them, and you had to start out with a low fire and gradually, you know, build it up.
Oh, yeah.
She used to make one for my sister Lillian's birthday because she loved them, and she'd mail it to her.
Are you kidding? And it would get there?
Mm-hmm.
Today it would never get there.
Probably not. Somebody would open it up and eat it, huh?
Yeah. Did your mother and dad ever get to return to Sweden?
No.
Did any of your family ever come here to visit?
In later years, my cousin's granddaughter came to Florida with some friends, and my sister Lillian got to talk to her on the phone.
That was the only connection. Did anyone do a family, do you know where in Sweden? They grew up, that kind of thing. Has anyone done a family
Oh, Don has, but it's so hard to get records from all these years if you didn't know the church that they belong to and where their records are kept. And now they're in a centralized place, like in the, I mean, like your county seat would be or something. But we didn't know the names of the churches. I have a second cousin, my real cousin's daughter lives in Minnesota. And she's been interested in that too, and she's been back to Sweden 3 or 4 times.
So she's been looking.
Yeah, she was a. She worked for the township at different, ran for offices, and she was a real go-getter, single child. And she came to visit us, but it was only a few hours they were here, just for dinner on Saturday, about 3 or 4 years.
Okay, we're back on.
But it was really nice, and I got to hear more about my cousins. My dad's brother, one of them, had come to the United States. I don't know if his family was someone born there, maybe most of them here. Anyway, they went back to Sweden to live when this cousin Elsa was 12 years old. I guess with the farming out there in the South Dakota, it was bad for his sinus or something, and he was kind of sickly from that. So they went back to Sweden, and they stopped in Chicago and had their picture taken at my aunt's house. And I have one of them. And so in later years, when my sister Lillian died, I wrote to Elsa, because she knew English yet.
Uh-huh.
And she's 92 now. And but she felt like she'd been writing long enough. She didn't want to write anymore. But they had a house in Sweden. And the two brothers and two sisters never married. And they ran the household, and they farmed it for many years, but then they gave up. Yeah, in Sweden.
Now, they would have been two brothers of your father.
They would have been nephews and nieces. Yeah.
His brother's children.
His brother's children.
Did your father come from a big family?
Yeah. He's got quite a number of... I got a lot of stuff on Bud here. Then they're on wrong few. I saved all things from the Roscommon paper. I never can find what I want the most. Johanna, Carl John, Anders Gustav. Oh, that's my dad. There's 3. And Ida, 4, 5, 6, and 7.
Mm.
Oh, here's, this is Franz Rydell. And he had a son, Adolf. That was my cousin. And his daughter, Helena, lives in Minnesota now.
Oh, okay. Do you remember your parents talking much about Sweden? Did they have fond recollections? Or
not very much. And I wish I had.
We always wish we would have asked more.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You're the same thing.
Elsa that I wrote to, they had lived on a farm in South Dakota. And her name was Mary, her older sister, Mary Elsa. And Edgar Marvin and Edwin Melvin. When I wrote to Elsa and found that out, she says, "Why, you have names just like my brothers." And they recently died, and Mary got quite ill. And I guess she's in a home now, and Elsa has her own apartment.
Oh. So you have some family contact here in the United States.
Yeah. not, Helena has contact with her, on her family's.
Uh-huh.
And one of the fellows knows English enough to write to her.
Oh, that's right. Were there any particular Swedish customs that your family followed, like at the holidays?
Oh, especially at Christmas time, they always had lutefisk, you know, that stinky fish that everybody says. But my
Did
mother...
Did you like it?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. She made a white sauce with it. You cooked it in the... You had to soak it first. It came real dried up.
Oh.
And, oh, they
Where
used to have it in
it?
Barrels. I think Chicago places, because there was a lot of Swedes in Chicago area. And they would order it. And the A&P store, years ago, would have it in barrels outside because they couldn't stand the smell in the store.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes the mailman would bring some out.
He knew what was in the package, I
guess. Yeah, I guess. So then my mother would fix that. And then there was a dish of like brown beans, and you cooked them. There was a little sugar and a little vinegar, and it's a kind of a sweet sour sauce on them. Those were real good. And on Christmas Eve day, they had like dip in the pot. There was certain broth with some meat in it, and you had a bowl of that broth, and you dip your bread in that.
Oh.
And it was a Swedish thing.
And that was you did that on Christmas Eve day.
Yeah. And then Christmas Day, we'd have roast chicken. And that was one time of the year we'd have an orange or two.
Mm-hmm.
And Swedish rye bread and cardamom coffee cakes or rolls.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she made those real good.
You do too.
A try. But.
And you now, did all your children must graduate from high school?
Yes.
Okay, let's give a little rundown of your children's name.
Melvin, he graduated in 1960, and he went to Northern College, or what was the one up north at the Sioux for a while?
Oh,
yeah.
It's called Lake Superior State now.
Yeah, it's changed. I can't remember what it was. And then he did go to Ferris and took an automotive course down there. And he works for Airway Automation in Grayling and loves that job. And Loretta went to Central Michigan for a year, and then she got married. And Mel had three boys, but the middle one died. And Loretta had, and Corey had two girls and two boys. And Jim has two daughters. He was inducted in the Army, and he ended up in Okinawa and met his wife there. And they have two daughters.
So did he go in the Army right from high school?
No, he was working in Detroit. He thought he might go into the Navy, and he had the recruiter come to the house, and he and his buddy had both. I don't know if they must have filled out some papers, but they never went through with it.
Mm-hmm.
Roger Barnes was his name.
Roger who?
Barnes.
Barnes, okay.
I gotta go to the bathroom again.
Oh, yeah. Okay, what was Jim doing?
Jim was working in Grayling with Bud at the Grayling Real outfit, and he changed and went to Kalkaska because they had a sawmill up there. And he was so discouraged. He says, I'm not getting anywhere here. And he really didn't want to go in the Navy. So Bud decided then, he says, I'm going to take him down to the city. And he'd made friends with Lucille Gronkowski's husband. And he was a designer. He worked in Detroit. And Bud thought, well, if he's interested in that, he could try out for it, like an apprentice. So he went down there, and the boss knew Bud's dad, because he'd worked with, yeah, he knew him. And he says to Jim a bit later, after he'd been there for a while, he says, your grandpa was really good, but you're going to be even better.
Oh.
Yeah. and Jim never went to school or anything. Yeah, it was just a knowledge that he had in his head. So he's done a lot of designing.
Never went, he did go in the Army then?
No, he didn't go.
He didn't go in anything?
No. But then he was drafted
a couple of
years later.
Oh, okay.
And he got a different job at Modern Engineering. So he was making better wages and doing well. So, of course, it took 18 months or 2 years out of his work deal to spend time in the service. And he met his wife over in Okinawa. And in 1968, they came back to the United States. But and John, he was inducted and ended up in Germany a couple times. And in the meantime, he married Nadine Kronick, and that didn't work out. And Don.
So he never came back here to live?
No, John never did. No. Then he finally married a girl from Lansing that he met later on, and she was real nice. But she had a brother out in Oregon, or Washington, and it was near the border. And he liked it real well out there, so he stayed. And then later, when Don got married, he and Pam took a trip out that way, and then they decided they'd like to go out there and live.
So you have two sons in Oregon, but Don is the one.
He's in the computer business, and he bought.
And he came back to buy this son.
Yeah. Yeah, he's been out there 23 years.
Okay, tell us about the store he bought, though.
He bought this little store, the owner, Raph.
What's it called?
Oak Park Grocery.
Oak Park Grocery.
Mm-hmm. And he kind of talked to Don. He says, you know, you can make really good making pizzas and baking, and there's good money in baking things. And I guess in kind of his oldest daughter, she says, oh, why don't you, Dad, you know, and kind of convinced him. But he finally made up his mind he would buy the store. But it's very slow in the summertime. You might have busy weekends and holidays, but he made a lot of changes over there, put in a nice big cooler and ice maker. And
so who's
all
here
kinds
all
of
summer
stuff.
To run it?
His wife, Pam, and the oldest daughter. But
they give it a whirl, won't they?
Yeah, I guess they will open it again and see how it goes this year. They might sell pizzas by the piece for something different.
Yeah, that works too. I wanted to get back to when your family home was moved over onto East Cedar Flight Drive, and was now the house that May Lance owned. The property to the west of you, can you tell us about that?
Well,
was the Skagerberg the next house, or was there something?
Yes,
in
no, there was
the
nothing, no houses in between Ed Skagerberg. He was a brother of Velma Osling, and he and his wife came up from Illinois. They had been working on a farm down there. But I remember when Laverne was first here, she says, I can't get used to all these trees, because they were used to a lot of open area on the farm.
Laverne was their daughter?
Laverne and they had two daughters, Laverne and Jean, and then Ralph and Norman.
Were their sons?
Mm-hmm. They had four children. And Ed contacted pneumonia when he was only 43 years old. There wasn't anything they could do for him. Pneumonia was pretty serious.
Sure.
It is, always is, but he died very young.
Oh, did he die in that home?
In the home,
Laverne's father.
Yeah.
Did the family stay there then?
Not for very long. They moved into Roscommon and were in a house that, I'm not sure if it's the Brown Beauty Bar One of those houses in there that they lived in.
When your parents moved there in 36, was that a log cabin, log house, or do you remember it?
Bud seems to remember that it was.
Yeah. Let's see the shapes. Well, then, who lived there after Skagerbrook left, went to town, do you remember?
There was another couple that lived there. My mother got acquainted with her. I think it was just a husband and wife. And she got to know her pretty well. Very nice. No, I don't.
Mm-hmm. Then did you know Mr. Jones that owned it later?
Carol Jones, yeah. His wife went to our church with us, and she sang in the choir with us. Can't think of her name now. Yeah, she was a real nice person.
Let's get back to, I wanted to talk about your parents. I wanted to ask if they spoke in the Swedish language when you were growing up, or did you learn any of it?
Well, they must have spoke enough so that we knew. They would probably speak when they didn't want us to understand what they were saying. Mm-hmm. But somehow we picked it up, and I was really interested in it. In when I got to be about 10 years old or so, I wrote a letter to one of my aunts in Sweden, and I have an answer to it that she wrote in Swedish. And she thought I was doing so well write in Swedish. And once in a while, my sister Eunice and I used to write back and forth in Swedish.
So you really learned it, mm-hmm, quite a lot of it. Or you learned it.
I can understand
well.
More that when you try to speak it, it's hard to think. I remember when Ann Carlson, what was her married name? She lived right in town. Her husband died years ago. Anyway, we'd meet in Glenn's Market, and we'd always say, "Good dog, frickin', who's more do you dog?" We were always trying to, and when you try to think of it on the moment, you know, it never comes out very good. Mm-hmm. But then she died a little later, and I said, "Gee, I don't have anybody to speak Swedish to anymore."
Oh.
And then a couple of years ago, there was a lady that came to our church in the summer. She was from California, and she spoke very well in the Swedish.
That was fun.
And she helped me translate some things. Mm-hmm. I think she's coming back this year, so I have something to look forward to.
But in your home, predominantly, they spoke English.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was nice that you were able to learn it, mm-hmm, somewhat anyway. So, and this picture of your father in town,
mm-hmm,
in front of a house next to where the village shop was. You think that was taken in the early 50s with Mr. Cal Shepherd?
Oh, I would.
Very nice. She's a pretty gal.
Huh?
She's a pretty gal.
Well.
Yes, it would have to be in the 50s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what else? Mert, you think we've covered everything pretty well?
I think so. I can't.
I know you have been very much the backbone of our congregation, so you've put in.
Yeah, it surprises me.
Your heart and soul into the church. That's wonderful. It wouldn't be there probably today without.
And if it hadn't been for my parents always going, and I was always willing to go with them, and
sure. And
that was a great part of our life. There's so many other things going on anymore that I don't think people have the same. Well, maybe they do, but I always think there's more things to do anymore than just to go to church. In this. Sometimes the Baptist church would have visiting pastors, and they'd preach every night during the week. We'd go to the one down in Swedetown, and I remember one time Pearl Solomon and I were sitting together in the pew, and their pews were very uncomfortable. The backs were so straight and all wood, and pretty soon we got the whispering, you know, and back and forth. And that minister up in front, speaking Swedish, you know, Bartist, you know, be quiet. Oh, we just kind of shrank down in our seats. And
where
never
was
said
your full another. Church? Where was your Baptist church?
In the Sweden town.
Is it still there?
No, they, Reverend Bell was here many years ago. His son was in the same class in high school as our Jim. And then they moved to Roscommon. Of course, they're up on the Maplehurst Hill now.
Oh, okay. And, so that church started in Sweetown?
Yeah, it started in Sweetown.
I didn't know that. It's always fun to learn this new stuff.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking Mrs. Solerum. She said her husband helped build that church, and they thought, well, before we ever had one, she thought, well, that would be a nice, close church to go to. They couldn't. They weren't allowed.
What do you mean?
They weren't. They didn't allow them to come to church because they weren't Baptists.
Oh, I see.
I should.
Mm-hmm. Well, in Signe's oral history, she talks about which families went to the Lutheran church, and she said the Cedermans went to the Baptist mm-hmm. church, because I thought they had been part of the Lutheran church, mm-hmm. and she said they were not.
No.
Gone to a Baptist
and,
church.
And Eva so. Martinson was, well, she was a Cederman, too. Mm-hmm. And in later years, she and her husband joined ours.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
which
I
we were real, yeah,
I'm
not sure. They were Baptists.
Okay. Well, I think we covered pretty much everything. It sounds like you had a nice childhood growing up here,
mm-hmm.
even though it was difficult.
Yeah, it was, like we felt like way out in the boondocks, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We used to wish we lived closer to town.
But how much time did you spend? You must have been able to go to the lake all the time.
Oh, yes. In the summertime, when we were rather small, my sisters, Ruth and Lily, would come up on a vacation. Generally, they were together and walk that long, hot way down to the lake, and you'd be all hot and bothered when you got home.
Uh-huh.
But at that time, the trees were so small, short.
Mm-hmm.
Now you can walk to the lake and get shade almost all the
sure.
way down to.
Sure.
Oh, and we'd go down to DeWitt's Corner. No, I learned a little bit, but not. My sister Gert, she could swim real well.
Yeah.
And she would even milk a cow. My dad got her a little pail so she could fill her own milk pail. And she rode the horse. So she was very active.
So you did enjoy the lake all summer, though. Did you get a cool breeze from it as far back as
no.
you were? Probably not.
I remember long, hot summers.
Yeah.
But they seemed long because we were kids and there wasn't
sure.
much to do.
Sure. Sure. Well, I think that we did quite well here. We covered your school and the church
yeah.
and your children. You were married in East Tallis. I love it.
Because you spend
place.
Time over there.
Yeah. Well, I thank you very much.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't
society.
Sign that paper.
Yeah, no. Okay, we'll take care of that. And we appreciate your time and,
mm-hmm.
and all your thoughts. That's great. Thank you. Okay. Merch has thought of something else we want to tell about.
Oh, I just talked through this.
Yeah.
I was trying to remember the year, but there was a time when we lived over on Burdell Road on that corner, and my dad had a nice chicken house, and right beside it, connected with it, was a, like we called a woodshed. We kept dry wood in there. Well, the chicken coop had a stove inside, and it burned wood naturally, and he went to check it in the morning, and he opened the draft a bit to get it started. Then he went over to the barn and took care of the animals and kind of forgot about the wood stove. And the next thing we knew, it had caught fire. And I think we only ended up with one chicken, and it burnt. My mother had a big trunk in the woodshed and with a lot of things that she kept in there. And oh, we...
It was tragic.
Yeah. And the fire was so hot that it cracked the kitchen window on our house, and we were terrified, you know, and it was snow on the ground at the time, so I think one of the neighbors below us had noticed it, and somehow somebody came along and they threw snow on the lawn so that it wouldn't catch fire. It was about the only thing you could do.
And how many chickens did they have?
Oh, probably about 20 chickens or something. Yeah, the warm air kept them laying good all winter. I guess when it got cold, they didn't like to lay eggs.
Sure.
So anyway, that was
one. And where did you take the eggs? Or who did you sell them?
My father used to take them into Roscommon, and he'd get paid for it or exchange it for groceries. Yeah.
Great, thank you.